lot of legacy platforms, or some, they placate the bank and credit union. Everything's around the corner. We have that slated. We're going to work on that, you know, and it's always something better is coming. And I heard that complaint actually in the conversations. Waiting for push provisioning is, as an example, push provisioning from the mobile banking app to a virtual wallet, or, you know, a mobile wallet. It's been promised by one of the interviewees. It's been promised for 2 years. That it was just around the corner, just coming. And I think there's a lot of that happening. It's always coming soon.
I was talking to a few banks, and they wanted to launch the small business card. And one of the things that they basically talked about is, look, I got to integrate this with my mobile banking application. And I'm like, why? Why do you want to bury this inside a mobile banking application? You should really think about what is the purpose of this card and how does this help the small business or the businesses, you know, optimize their payments and their fund flows, et cetera. So think about this as a tool that you're giving to the business, not that I need to embed this into my mobile banking application.
That's a huge example, right? That's exactly the right like mind shift you have to go through, right? Because we're so built to sort of compete in this environment of, I have a set of distribution channels. I have a set of products that sit essentially on the shelf in those different distribution channels. And I'm launching a new product. I have to find a way to plug that into my mobile banking. And maybe you do, but to your point, the question you need to start with is, what experience or outcome am I trying to create for my customer?
Exactly.
And what's the best way to do that? And the thing that's cool about modern card issuing is we've completely abstracted away all the details. And so like, maybe they don't even need to get a physical card. Maybe it's all powered by one-time virtual cards that are issued by the software when you need it. Or maybe you have to be able to issue multiple cards to different members of a family, and the cards have different capabilities that are tuned to the individual members of the family, and there's an app that controls it at a household level. Like, there's a million different ways to think about product development when you divorce yourself away from that physical card, mobile banking mindset that we've sort of been stuck in over the last 10 years.
I think the one area that we notice is kind of a little bit counterintuitive is a lot of the card executive take more time to consider whether they should do modernization than actually doing the modernization themselves. We have noticed, and Gary and I have talked about this before, right? I mean, on average, we notice issuers are taking at least 2 years, up to 2 years, to talk about or thinking, contemplating to modernize, right? In some cases, even longer. But the actual modernization itself, right, is 2 to 3 years, right? So it's that kind of that just kind of, I would say, artificially making the timeline longer. It actually, the actual effort itself is reasonable. But when you are adding in the 2 to 3 years of contemplating and waiting and analysis and prognosis and not taking any action, that make it worse. Right, that make it unbearable. And going back to your point earlier, Gary, right, the digital world moved much, much faster than what we have experienced in the last 50 years, those five cycles, right? So if you don't take any action right now, that to me is the biggest mistake.
When you think about sort of how modern card issuing fits into what fintech is building, the way I kind of split it out is there's sort of three different ways to think about it. One is the card is a product itself, right? And so obviously, there have been lots of fintech companies that have launched card products. I think for the most part, they started in debit. They're now starting to migrate over to charge cards and to credit. But when you think about, you know, the product itself and the card as a product construct, the innovation is all around different ways that that construct can be expressed to the end user. So it's not just a plastic or metal card. It is a set of virtual cards that you can issue for all different types of capabilities, including getting free trials or, you know, signing up for subscriptions that you can manage. So enabling more sort of flexible uses of the credential. It's also making the credential itself more flexible. So we see this at a network level with what Visa is doing around flex credential and the ability for a card number to point to multiple different funding sources. I think Affirm, Alan mentioned Buy Now, Pay Later. They're going to be one of the first companies that's going to build on that flex credential to tie debit and Buy Now, Pay Later together within the same card construct controlled by the end customer, which is pretty cool. And then, of course, you know, David mentioned digital wallets and Apple Pay, and none of that is going away. In fact, banks are really aggressively trying to catch up on digital wallets through Pays and a number of other initiatives. And so I think at a card product level, you see lots of innovation around the construct and sort of how it's expressed to the end customer. The second manifestation of the card in a fintech context is the card is a business model. And again, this is where I go back to sort of the shift we're seeing in fintech. Everyone started in debit. This is why smaller community banks are oftentimes the partners for fintech companies, is that they have Durbin-exempt interchange rates that they can offer. We're starting to see that migrate away. And, you know, these Durbin-exempt business models where it's just built around debit interchange, those are kind of no longer acceptable in fintech, and fintech companies are trying to expand beyond that. So you see a lot more competition around charge cards. You see a lot more competition around credit cards. And a lot of the barriers that used to exist for fintech companies getting into credit are going away because a lot of modern card issuing platforms can support debit and credit. There's a much more robust private credit industry that can sort of provide the balance sheet behind the credit card. And so you see a lot more innovation moving into charge cards and credit and not just being stuck in debit. And then the final thing I just wanted to mention really quickly is the card as data. And this is, I think, the one that gets a little bit lost. But when you think about, you know, building digital products, which, you know, Gary, I think that was something you mentioned at the very beginning, like how do you build digitally native products to be competitive in this new environment? I think one thing we need to sort of wrap our heads around is that a lot of the products that consumers want don't look at all like card products, right? And so I'll use like Ramp as an example here, but I think this construct applies pretty broadly. Ramp isn't a card. That's not the core product. The core product is a set of software workflows that are designed to help companies save money. And you can understand how that same approach of building software that's designed to provide automation, intelligence, that's designed to save money, save time, that type of construct can work extraordinarily well in B2C, in B2B. It works in all kinds of different use cases. And the key is, it's built around software. Software is the product. That's what you're buying. And the card is just an enabler for all of the software to work. And so the card is what's transmitting the real-time data. The card has APIs built into it. And so you're able to connect all of the different software workflows that you're building. When a transaction happens, it can trigger a set of actions to be taken. And so all of the data and intelligence built into Ramp or similar products is enabled by the card sort of facilitating the data transfer across that software product, but the card itself is not really the point. And I think directionally, that's where fintech is headed. And when I think about where banks need to go to sort of keep pace, it's thinking beyond the card as a product construct and thinking more of, is it an enabler for the types of software-driven experiences that consumers and businesses want?
I think as an industry, what we notice is, I mean, we came out from the pandemic largely, I would say, doing pretty well, right? There were some initial pressures, you know, causing interest income to decrease, but the industry as a whole rebounded pretty well. I mean, we are seeing year-to-year 6% increase in account openings. So it's not a, you know, in a really bad stage. But I think that the risk to your point, Gary, is if you don't take action, as an industry, we are now at the verge of entering the sixth cycle. And this number six cycle is going to be dominated by or supercharged by technology innovations, right? So a lot of the questions that you see previously, right, in the survey are pointing to innovations, are pointing to digital, omnichannel, right? We also see AI, Gen AI popping up on the screen. But I would say that probably the most important risk or opportunity and a horizon is the diversifications of payment methods. Because that to me is kind of the quote unquote the killer, right? You know, for these legacy card processors, that they couldn't handle anything other than card, right? And we are starting to see, right, you know, the emergence of the trend now in the industry, like, you know, buy now, pay later is just the starting point, right? We are already seeing a lot of new payment types are popping up, right, you know, in other geography, and sooner rather than later, it will arrive in US. So I think, you know, in the short term, right, a lot of the going after digital and innovations, from the short-term perspective, I think it makes perfect sense to us. But what we need to really keep in mind is, right, the industry that we are dealing with when we entering this sixth cycle is going to be very different than what we have seen previously. Now, the question is why, right? Why we are not quite there yet as an industry, right? And it is largely driven by two factors. One, it's just the heavy reliance on the legacy processing, right? You can see the numbers and the research from, you know, David's paper, right? I mean, we are, you know, the card industry is one of the bigger laggards, right? When it comes to, you know, payment modernization, comparing to other part of the payment ecosystems, there's still a lot of legacy processing. The second factor I would call it is the card executives' fear of modernization, right? There is a general fear of getting into, you know, into modernization and giving up my legacies and changing the way how we operate, right? So we will talk a little bit more in some of the subsequent, discussion, but that's kind of, you know, my take on, you know, the kind of the near term as well as the, you know, the longer term impact.